Thank you, Chief LaBarge, for that very, very kind and overly generous introduction. I was told I could take about 20 minutes to speak, but after that introduction, I guess I have about 10 minutes left. I am so delighted to be here with this legendary organization and in this wonderful room, which is truly amazing. But it is, above all, such an honor to address the 10th annual Dialogue and Friendship Dinner and to join this history of such illustrious past speakers. Let me begin by thanking Azim Shamshiv and the board and executive team of the IDI GTA for inviting me here to speak this evening. So thank you very much. Thanks also to the hosting committee for all their great work in putting this event together. These events don't happen on their own, and a lot of thought and hard work goes into their staging. Let me also salute and thank the Honorable Reza Maridi, who is a great friend of higher education and research. Thank you for your wonderful opening remarks and for bringing those greetings from our Premier Kathleen Wynne. So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm pleased to see so many distinguished guests and friends and colleagues here this evening. And I extend my congratulations in advance to those of you who will soon be honored with awards later this evening. As Chief LaBarge mentioned, I am recently appointed in November 2013, so I'm about 15 months into my term as president at U of T. And one of the things that excited me so much about the prospect of becoming president was that I've spent a lot of time over my academic career studying the economies of urban regions and the role that major institutions such as research universities play in the development of those urban economies. So now, as president of Canada's largest, and I would certainly argue most respected university, I have the opportunity to put some of those ideas into practice. My starting point for this is that the relationship between universities and their host city regions is fundamentally symbiotic. It's mutually enriching, and it's a dynamic that unfolds along multiple dimensions. Indeed, universities and city regions collaborate on many of the themes that are at the very heart of the Intercultural Dialogue Institute: community building, peace building, social innovation, opportunity, and prosperity. But before I get too far ahead of myself, let me start with an image from the past. So imagine that you are standing at the corner of Bay and Richmond Streets looking east. There's a large sign announcing Christie's Biscuit Factory and another one for Scotland Woolen Mills Company, where apparently you could buy a beautifully hand-tailored suit for $25. Up the street is the Neelan House, where you could rent rooms for $1.50 a night. Muirhead Company Paint Factory is at 215 King Street East, and the Reed Lumber Company is just a block further down the way. Now, from this vantage point, you can count 5 water towers and no fewer than 17 smokestacks, a good number of them in full plume, so the air is thick. Many of the predominantly brick buildings that you can see around you are heavily stained with soot. Welcome to downtown Toronto, circa 1913. According to the Census of Canada, just 2 years later in 1915, 35% of Toronto's workforce, which at the time was defined as being, you know, age 10 years and older, 35% of that workforce was employed in the manufacturing sector. And the clothing and textile industry led the way. Strikingly, according to that census, clothing and textile workers outnumbered bankers by 50-1. Even more astonishingly, for every accountant in Toronto in 1911, there were 5 musical instrument makers. How times have changed. So today, The Toronto CMA is the third largest technology hub in North America, comprising some 43% of Canada's tech sector investment. The city is the third largest financial services center in North America. Toronto is also home to North America's third largest health sciences cluster and is among really the top 10 life science centers in the world. Our film and television sector ranks third in North America, employing conservatively something like 25,000 people. Production companies invested $1.2 billion in on-location filming in Toronto last year alone. So what has happened between 1913 and now? Well, obviously, the world has changed, and the Toronto region has changed along with it. And I would argue that the driving forces behind that change have been and continue to be immigration and education. Since 1901, more than 16 million immigrants have arrived and settled in Canada, a greater number of them making their home in the Toronto region than anywhere else in the country. In fact, today, the Toronto region is home to well over one-third of Canada's foreign-born population. That's more than 2.5 million people. Successive waves of immigrants have come here in search of economic opportunity and also for social and political stability. And they have helped to create the world's most multicultural region. As you all know, I'm sure, half of those living in Toronto today, the Toronto region, were born outside of Canada, and you've heard from Mayor Crombie what the comparable stats are in Mississauga, which are even higher. The flow of talent that has come to Toronto has witnessed and in many ways helped to fuel an equally startling transformation in post-secondary education, particularly in the last half century or so. Now, Minister Moridi may be interested to know that in 1920, in all of Ontario, there were only 9,000 post-secondary students at the undergraduate level and fewer than 200 graduate students. In that same year, there were only 3,700 female university students in all of Canada. Now today, more than 83,000 students are enrolled at the University of Toronto on its three campuses alone. And more than half of them, I'm proud to say, are women. So things have really come a long, long way. Not surprisingly, the diverse multicultural composition of our city region is very much reflected in the enrollment of our universities and our colleges. Today, well over half of U of T's students self-identify as a so-called visible minority. More than half, and we still call them a visible minority. So obviously we have to get new nomenclature, new terminology. And one in four is the first in their family to attend university. One in four. Well, these facts are impressive on their own, but why do they matter? And what do they mean for the GTA and for Ontario and for Canada? Well, I believe that they underscore how the Toronto region and its universities and colleges function as critically important portals of opportunity for all segments of our diverse population. Education has helped this region leverage more fully the talent that is born here or that arrives here from across Canada and around the world. This is a huge advantage in today's knowledge economy, and it has provided the wherewithal for our city to reinvent itself, literally reinvent itself, continually over time, as the contrast, the comparison between 1913 and today demonstrates so well. We've gone from trading post, textiles and tanning, to farm implements and food processing, and more recently to finance, pharma, filmmaking, and artisanal foods. Toronto has benefited tremendously from the output of human capital from its universities and colleges, whose graduates have become the literal backbone of an educated, diversified, and highly creative workforce. Most critically, immigration and education have contributed vastly to our sense of community, our social well-being, our individual and our collective prosperity. And I submit that this is the most important aspect of the partnership between universities like the University of Toronto and their host city regions. As some of you will know, I have been speaking about the principal elements of this partnership between universities and cities for some time now, and over the last year I've had the privilege of speaking at places like the Toronto Region Board of Trade, at the C.D. Howe Institute, and elsewhere. So let me spend a moment on describing and analyzing some of those aspects of that partnership here. And I also want to address what I think are really vital catalysts for that partnership, particularly access and opportunity. First, as I mentioned at the outset, a strong university helps to build a strong city, and I think the reverse is also true. A strong host city really enables a university to excel nationally and internationally, and it makes my job a lot easier as a president. And I suggest that there are three central aspects to this partnership: dynamism, stability, and openness to the world. So when it comes to dynamism, as I have already demonstrated, universities impart dynamism and resilience to the economies of city regions, helping them to reinvent themselves in the way that I've just described in Toronto. And in the same way, the diverse local populations in these city regions bring vitality and energy and ingenuity to local universities and colleges. And this is most readily apparent in our students, of course, but it is also evident in our faculty, our staff, and our alumni. But at the same time that we have a story here about dynamism and resilience, there's also an important story about stability. Universities are tremendously important stabilizing forces on urban economies and on the local neighborhoods that they inhabit. Let's look at U of T. Our sheer size generates really substantial economic impact within the region. In addition to those 83,000 students that I talked about, we directly employ more than 18,000 people on three campuses. That is more than Chrysler and GM employ in all of Canada combined, a fact that doesn't seem to be all that well known or appreciated, but it's one that I like to share with people. The other point to make here is that we've been in Toronto a long time, and we're not going anywhere anytime soon. We're here to stay. Moreover, we work in partnership with communities across the region in a mode that brings benefit to both parties. And let me just give you a few examples. I love talking about an initiative that comes out of the health sciences at U of T called Imagine, which is led by students in medicine, nursing, pharmacy, social work, and other professions. They provide free healthcare services at Queen and Bathurst for the homeless, for those experiencing mental health challenges, and for new immigrants who are not yet covered by OHIP. Another example from our campus in Scarborough, the University of Toronto Scarborough, where our students work closely with community partners at the East Scarborough storefront, serving the social needs of residents in Kingston Galloway and Orton Park. And at the University of Toronto Mississauga, our faculty and our students at our Mississauga Academy of Medicine and at the Institute for Management and Innovation, so that's MAM and IMI for short, work in partnership, as you heard Mayor Crombie say, with local institutions, local hospitals, healthcare institutions, businesses in the life science sector, and of course in great partnership with the city of Mississauga. This is a tremendously mutually beneficial relationship. These are just three examples from scores at U of T, the institution, of course, that I know best, but they're also typical of the kinds of stories and the kinds of examples that you will find from institutions of higher education all around the Toronto region. So I've talked about dynamism, I've talked about stability. Let me now talk about openness and how universities connect their host regions to the world. Let me share some more numbers with you. In 2013 alone, authors with a U of T affiliation produced over 15,500 publications in scholarly journals, together with scholars at other institutions. Their collaborators were based at over 8,000 institutions in hundreds of municipalities around the world. This is important because, quite obviously, the present and the future prosperity of Toronto and Canada depend on our ability to access and use knowledge, and not just the knowledge that we produce locally, but also knowledge that is produced in other leading centers of research and innovation around the world. So our universities are really vital gateways to these global knowledge networks and linkages, connections to other leading sources of innovation and knowledge production around the world. And that kind of connectivity creates all kinds of benefits for the host region. And the host region returns the favor. So at the same time, Toronto's cultural buzz, its social harmony, our safe and our vibrant neighborhoods, our stable property markets, our public schools and libraries, our global reputation as a welcoming place, and other aspects of urban life that we all take for granted, probably far too much, these things make us a magnet for talent from around the world. I know everybody in this room appreciates that. And this is surely one of the reasons why now more than 20% of this year's incoming undergraduate class at U of T is comprised of international students. In 1996, that number was only about 2.7%, so we've gone from 2.7 to now 20%. And they come from over 900 different municipalities around the world. So these are key aspects of the partnership between universities and cities: dynamism, stability, and openness to the world. It's that partnership that is so important, and it's a partnership that amplifies the strengths of both partners, the university and the city. Moreover, I would submit that this partnership, with all of its different aspects, and I've just touched on a few of them here this evening, this partnership has done more for community building, social innovation, opportunity, and prosperity than any other single force in the history of this region. So as we think about the future of this region, the future of this partnership, I spend a lot of my time thinking about the future of the university and opportunities and challenges that come our way. Increasingly, we are being asked to justify our existence. We're being asked to demonstrate the value of a university education. Well, there are many ways that I think we can do this. I'm looking at the other university presidents in the room because I know that they are engaging in very much the same kinds of conversations. I think one way to respond is by drawing on exactly the kinds of examples that I've just been talking about, to emphasize some of the ways in which universities like U of T have helped a place like Toronto reinvent itself over time, and talking about how the region's very resilience and has been made possible by the universities and colleges that have played such a leading role in fostering this. So that would be one way to address this challenge. There are other sources of evidence as well that one could point to, including pointing to lifelong earnings data, quality of life studies, studies that demonstrate how university-educated citizens are more engaged in civic life and beyond. Nevertheless, I think the value of a university education should not be taken for granted. Indeed, I would say that our sector faces significant competition from other sources of knowledge creation, and its comparative value is the subject of vigorous debate. Let me hasten to add that I think this debate is healthy and important, and in the best university tradition, we certainly do not shrink from the challenge of engaging in these kinds of debates. But I have to say that often one hears solutions or prescriptions being offered for the future of university education that I think are fairly simplistic, fairly knee-jerk kinds of responses to the sorts of pressures that we feel today. Pressures to reform higher education by shortening degree programs, focusing more on skills training, an exclusive focus on so-called job readiness. These, my friends, I submit to you, are really not the answer. Instead, I would argue that we think about undergraduate education in a different way, and you heard some clues from that in the introduction a few minutes ago. We should be looking to, among other things, our century-long partnership with our city region for inspiration. Accordingly, I would argue that our goal should be to prepare our students not just for short-term employability, but for a lifetime of success in any career, including careers that haven't yet even been created. And we should be preparing our students to create those careers for themselves and really become active participants in that process whereby city regions reinvent themselves over time. I would suggest that we need to seek the right balance between depth and specialization on the one hand and breadth of education on the other. At the same time, I think we need to reaffirm the enduring value of a broad liberal education, but also to ask ourselves how we can help our students extract the full benefit from that education. We need to demonstrate more clearly how the education we provide prepares our graduates for a lifetime of fulfillment, while also contributing to the economic, social, and political success of the region, the province, the nation, and indeed the world. And we also need to anticipate and respond to disruptive changes in the modes and mechanisms for education and knowledge production in light of the growing challenges to the traditional model of university education that technology-mediated learning introduces. After all, the kinds of challenges that we will increasingly confront as a global community, they are more intertwined, more complex than ever before. Everything from cybersecurity and climate change to global epidemics, energy crises, and inequality of opportunity. So I would suggest that answering these challenges will require not just skills, but more fundamental competencies, and this is where broad research-intensive universities like the University of Toronto really excel. And it comes down to things like critical thinking, quantitative reasoning, effective writing and communication skills, problem-solving abilities, ethical and social reasoning, ability to work effectively in teams, entrepreneurship. Indeed, in this day and age, I believe it's not simply what one studies, but increasingly how one studies, whether a student's discipline of choice is engineering, economics, epidemiology, or English. The methodology is what is really critical. Researching, reasoning and arguing, creating, testing and defending arguments or hypotheses. And this is the lifeblood of a research-intensive university. So this brings me to my final point and back to my starting point, which is the relationship and the partnership between the university and the city. Universities need to accentuate and elevate the value of being here. By that, I mean the following. It's interesting to note something of a paradox. We've heard a lot about the rise of online learning, which has been frequently characterized as presenting a kind of a new technology that has the potential to really disrupt our traditional business model in the education world. But it has also been a boon in many ways, an unexpected benefit, which is really interesting. The truth is that online learning actually compels universities to ensure that the value of being here in person, in the classroom, in the library, in the lab, or on the playing field, that the value of being here is sufficiently great to compete successfully against purely digital modes of teaching and learning. In fact, I believe we are already seeing how new tools and technologies can help us rethink the way that we teach in the classroom and beyond. And paradoxically, online learning is remaking campus-based education. Critical components of this effort are things like experience-based education, service learning, urban research and partnerships, co-op programs, internships, all of which are fostered by working in collaboration with our many partners in surrounding local communities. In other words, the city itself becomes our best asset in meeting the challenge of online learning models. And universities like the one that I'm honored to lead already do a good deal of this kind of thing, but we could be doing so much more. This is a win-win opportunity for our students, faculty and staff, and for the remarkable residents of the city region in which we are so fortunate to be located. So the University of Toronto is indeed embracing its role as a city builder on all three of its campuses, and it welcomes opportunities to collaborate with other actors and organizations to advance the quality of life and quality of place here in the Greater Toronto region. Well, I've now come to the end of my allotted time with much more that remains to be said. I hope that I've provoked some food for thought or provided some food for thought, particularly on this symbiotic relationship between universities and city regions and how they collaborate on community building, peace building, social innovation, opportunity, and prosperity. Fortunately, I am in the perfect company this evening. The Intercultural Dialogue Institute and the annual Dialogue and Friendship Dinner, now a decade old, have a strong and very distinguished record of fostering debate, asking and answering hard questions, and greatly enriching our community. It has been a tremendous privilege to offer this keynote. Thank you so much for your kind attention.